Hello dear students, hope you all well. Today we are going to read our next chapter, Unit 6, Section B, The Little People. So let's start the chapter.
Let's start our chapter. Are you fond of traveling? Here they are asking you that do you like traveling? How do you prefer to travel? By train, by air or by sea? Again they are asking that do you like to travel or how do you like to travel, as you like to travel by train or by air or by sea. And then they are telling you to give three reasons for your preferences. And again you have to discuss the risk involved in each modes of traveling. Okay, so this is the starting of the beginning line. Through this, as we all can understand that this chapter may be related with the traveling. Let's begin our chapter. Jonathan Swift wrote about the adventures of Lemuel Gulliver, who had a passion for sea travel. During one of his voyages, he was shipwrecked to close to an island near the South Sea. He managed to reach the island, which he thought was uninhabited, read on to find out what he discovered. Jonathan Swift, he was a famous writer, has wrote about the adventure of Lemuel Gulliver. Lemuel Gulliver was a person who had a passion for the sea travel, and during one of his voyages means journey by sea or by in space. So voyages means journey by sea. So when he was on a journey by sea, there was a shipwreck. Shipwreck means broken ship, or that some accident, or to be left without a ship because of its loss or destruction at sea. So some shipwreck means he was without ship, or something happened, some destruction happened, that is why he was without ship. Somehow he managed to reach the island, which he thought was uninhabited, means nobody lived there, which he thought it is isolated. Now read on what to find what he discovered. I accepted a lucrative offer from Captain William Pritchard, master of the Antelope, who was making a voyage to the South Sea. Here he is saying, Gulliver is saying that he accepted a well-paying, lucrative means in that they are paying you a lot. So he accepted the same offer from his captain William Pritchard, who was master of Antelope, and then he is going to making a voyage to South Sea. We set sail from Bissell, and our voyage was at first very fine. Then he said that he started sailing from Bristol and his voyage was very fine at the first. However, we had hardly been 2 weeks into our voyage when a violent storm drove us to the northwest of Van Diemen's Land and eventually shipwrecked us. Then what happened all of a sudden? It's been only 2 weeks into their voyage, and suddenly a violent storm came and everything has changed. Eventually they met with a shipwreck, and to be left without a ship because of its loss or destruction at sea. Now what happened? Our crew made the best use of lifeboats, but the gales were so strong. Gales means winds. Okay, so what other crew member did? They used lifeboats, but what happened at the end? The winds was very strong that they were quickly overturned as they are trying to escape themselves from their gales, but gales was more stronger than them. What became of my companion in the boat, as well as of those who escaped on the rock or were left in the vessel? So now here he doesn't know what happened with his companion. He thought that they might have escaped on the rock or something, somewhere. Not know. I can only conclude that they were all lost. What they conclude at the end? That they all lost. For my own part, I swam as fortune directed me. And for him, what he did? He swam. Means he started swimming in that water and was pushed forward by wind and tide to a desolate island. And when he started swimming, he reached a desolate island, means uninhabited, where nobody lived, where I saw no living beings. He said that where he hardly saw a living being. I lay down on the grass, which was very short and soft. What he did, he lay down on the grass, which was very short and soft. I slept soundly for what I think for was about 9 hours. Then he said, I was slept for about 9 hours, and for it was just daylight when I woke up. I attempted to rise, but was not able to stir. As I happened to lie on my back, I found my arms and my legs were strongly fastened on each side to the ground, and my hair, which was long and thick, was tied down in the same manner. Now, after 9 hours, when he woke up, on he attempted to rise. What happened with him? He was not able to stir, means he was not able to move. His arms and legs were strongly fastened to ground, means tie on the ground, and his hairs also tied down in the same manner, neither able to sit up nor move. Now he is not able to sit up nor move. I could only look upwards. The sun began to grow hot and light hurt my eyes. What the one thing which he able to do is that he just could look upward only to the sun, and sun was shining very brightly. I heard a confused noise about me, but in posture I lay, I could see nothing except the sky. In a little time, I felt something moving on my left leg. It advanced gently forward over my body and came almost up to my chin. Bending my eyes downward as much as I could, I saw what looked like a human creature, not 6 inches high, with a bow and an arrow in his hand, and a quiver at his back. Now what happened? He was tied very badly, and he just could be able to see the sun only, not anything. And he heard some noise, some voices, but he could not move his legs or his chin or everything. His almost all body parts are tied badly. He just bending his eyes downwards as he just see a human creature, not long than 6 inches, not high than 6 inches, and they are having bow and arrow in his hands and quiver at his back. Quiver means a case used for carrying arrows. Okay, arrows in which they, as you all have seen in old movies or somewhere, they are carrying quiver at their back and they taking out arrows in that. Okay, that is called a quiver. Almost at the same time, I felt at least 50 more of same kind, as I imagine, following the first. From sheer astonishment, I roared so loud that they all ran back in a fright, and some of them seemed to suffer injury from the falls they got by leaping from my body onto the ground. However, they soon returned, and one of them, who ventured so far as to get a full sight of my face, lifting up his hands, I, by way of admiration, cried out in a shrill but distinct voice, "Hakina Degul." The others repeated the same word several times. If only I knew what they meant. Now what happened? The human creature, which is not 6 inches high, very small tiny creatures, they almost same, and at least 50 of the same kind, they all moving on his body, and it was complete silent or complete astonishment, total very, means he was completely astonished to see them, that this much tiny creature is still here on our earth. So he roared loudly and everybody was reined back in fear, and some of them fall down from his body and they got injured. And after some time, they again came back, and they are having like their eyes and way, their admiration. Again they cried out. They all are cried out in a very shrill or distinct voice. Their voice is like very shrill, and they all are saying, "Hakina Dugul." and they all are repeating the same word many times. Only I knew what they meant, because he doesn't know what the meaning of it. I lay all this while in great uneasiness. So what he did, what I did, what Gulliver did, he just still laying on the same grass. At length, struggling to get loose, I was able to break the strings and wrench out the pegs that fastened my arm to the ground. And while I'm struggling all those, though I take out, or I was able to break the string, I discovered how they had bound me. So with a violent pull, I loosened the string that tied down my hair on the left side. Now I just able to return my head about 2 inches. And he loosened the string which was tied down on the left side also, and now he was able to turn his head about 2 inches. The creatures ran off a second time before I could seize them, whereupon there was a great shout in a very shrill accent, and after it ceased, I heard one of them cried aloud, Tolgophonic. No sooner had the cry been made than my left hand was covered with tiny arrows that pricked me like so many needles. They set another volley of arrows into the air. Some fell on my body and some on my face, which I immediately covered with my left hand. Now what happened? The creatures ran off at the second time when they saw that I freed myself from this pegs or from the strings. Then they all started coming in the in a fast manner, and they all are shouting in a shrill accent or shrill voice, that is, they are crying Tolgophonic. And as soon as they said Tolgophonic, they started showering their arrows in the air, and they all come like a small prick, or we can say a prick like or tingling like feeling I have after having their arrows on my face. And what I did, I covered my face immediately with the hands. When the shower of arrows was over, I groaned with the grief and pain when they stopped doing this shower of arrows. So I started groaning with the grief or pain, and then on my striving again to get loose, they discharged another volley larger than the first, and some of them attempted with spears to stick me in the sides. And when they stop, or I feel like now they have stopped, what they did, they started, and this was the larger than the first one, and this time they use spears, stick. But by good luck, I had on a leather jacket which they could not pierce, and by good luck I was wearing leather jacket which they cannot pierce, so that safe from the spears yet. But what was in store for me next, I never could have imagined. So I got protected through that leather jacket from the spears. Spears is a long pointed stick, okay. So but now what they have next for him, that he doesn't know. So this is only a small extract from the Gulliver Travel, which was written by Jonathan Swift. Next, I think you all have understood the chapter. Thank you so much.